Joining me now is Dr. Soumitra Das, who's the director of the National Institute of Biomedical Genomics. And the question these days are the variants and the mutations that are circulating, not just in India, but across the world. And Dr. Das will give us more information and throw some light on what is essential at this moment for genomic sequencing in the country. Dr. Das, thank you so much for joining us today. Firstly, would like to ask you, what is the problem with the Delta variant at this moment? We're looking at another mutation called the Delta Plus. Please share some insights as head of INSACOG as to what it means to India and what it should mean to the world.
First of all, you have to remember this SARS coronavirus is an RNA virus. So mutation is nothing surprise. So because of this error-prone replication, this virus tend to mutate, and the mutations that are going to help the virus to enter efficiently or to escape the immune challenge of the host are usually naturally selected. So, you know, you can you expect that this virus is going to keep on mutating, and some of these mutations will be of concern and some of them are actually not so of concern. It could be of interest. Now, you know, as you know, that the virus started from last year. We had this Wuhan strain. Then there was a D614G, which was a mutation. And that was actually helping the virus to make more efficiently contact with the AC2 receptor of the host. And it was effectively transmitting into different populations. So, and you could see, we have actually shown last year from 1,000 genome sequencing coordinated by NIBNG, National Institute of Biomedical Genomics, along with 5 other laboratories of Department of Biotechnology. And we showed that how this D614G outplayed all the other strains, even the Wuhan strain, and spread it all. That was 2020. But at the end of the year, we started seeing that there are other variants coming in the backdrop of D614G. And, you know, as you all know, that first it started with the UK variant. Now we call it as an alpha variant. Then after that, there were some South African variant, which we call a beta variant. Now, what is this variant is, you know, all these variants are strains. I mean, but all variants are not strains, but all strains are variants, right? So that you have to remember. So the one that actually with time, we can see it, that this variant is aggressively infecting the host and actually somehow outplaying the other variant abundance. Then we started saying this is a variant of under investigation, VUI, or we can say variant of interest. Once we start seeing that this variant is actually somehow affecting the treatment regimen or affecting the infectivity or you know, the vaccine challenge, all these things, when we see it, then we started saying this is a variant of concern. When there is a proof, it's not like prediction, but there is proof that there is an immune escape, there is more infectivity, more transmissibility, more severity, some of those things, then we call it as a variant. And when it comes to a level that it is actually really force us to change our strategy and then look at it in a different way to strategize how to combat this virus, how to change our treatment regimen, how to change our vaccine policy, then we call it a variant of high concern. So these are the steps. Now, what you said correctly, that this is now the Delta variant, we started calling as a VOC. Now this VOC, now this Delta variant will also have different sublineages. So there is a lineage which is Delta variant, which we earlier have called at some time double mutant. Actually, it's an Indian variant with some key mutations. I don't want to get into that detail, but those key mutations we believe might have some changes in the property of the virus. Right. But all these things, you know, some of these things are predictive because we try to correlate the sequence variations and some data from the clinical scenario and try to find out that this is going to be a major concern or minor concern. At the same time, we need to do some biology experiment with this and to figure it out whether this has a real cause and concern. both, right? So if you can really match up that because of this mutation, there's a change in the conformation of the spike protein, and now it has a differential ability to interact with the receptor, then it is an altered function, and that becomes a proof. So at this moment, experiments are going on in different laboratories across the world and even in India to attribute whether this mutation is really going to affect the virus property in a way that it has more transmissibility or more infectivity, or you know, it has more severity. At this moment, strictly speaking, we don't have enough data to say that it is causing more severe disease. But it is definitely the Delta variant compared to the other variant, Alpha, Beta, and others. You can say that it is actually infective. Okay? But now Delta plus is one more mutation in the background of the Delta variant. Now the Delta plus is actually misnomer. We call it actually A.Y.1 or AY2. Now 1 and 2, there will be mutations. Now the fact that it has somehow acquired one mutation from the South African variant, which was immune skeptical. So we started thinking that there is a possibility that this particular variant might also be an immune skeptical. But again, sufficient data needs to be generated with the whatever sequences we are getting, whatever clinical relevances we are getting from different metadata that we call metadata from different hospitals and other things. Then when we actually align with it and see it, then we can actually convincingly tell you that this has a real impact on the infectivity or the severity. At this moment, we don't have enough data to say it, but definitely it is a variant of concern. Any sublineages under the Delta will be considered as a variant of concern. That is the rule. So the Delta virus is actually a variant of concern. So I just elaborated a little more, whatever is, you have to convey you got.
So, after being classified as a variant of concern as well by the Indian government, the Delta Plus, the question that most people would now ask is, would we have enough evidence to show or to prove that it's either evading or not evading vaccines, or it's either not evading antibodies or immunity that has been developed through natural infection? Is there any conclusive evidence on that, or it hints towards that fact at this moment?
Right. You said it correct. Actually, it hints towards the fact, as I told you, because that it has acquired one mutation, which is from South African variant, we started thinking that it might have some property like that. But again, we need to have experimental verification of that, validations of that. And we don't have enough cases that vaccine breakthroughs are always happening because of the Delta plus. We can't say it. We don't have enough cases that all the reinfection cases are for Delta plus. That also we don't have data. So as the day passed, and that's how I was just saying that maybe next week we'll have enough data to call it that whether there is a correlation.
India has sequenced at least 45,000 samples. Genome sequencing has been done for that. And we have seen some 40 cases. But where do you see the emergence of the cases? In which states are you likely to see an upward trend of cases that are now emerging from the Delta Plus variant?
At this moment, it's very difficult to say because, it is kind of a sporadic in different states. As you see the release that has happened from the ministry yesterday, health ministry, that it is quite, spread it in several states. So we can't really say that this is a state-wise distribution, but we are actually closely monitoring and seeing that is it actually accumulating in a particular state or in a particular population, that we are actually having a close watch.
And so in order to keep a close watch, INSACOG has also added 10 more labs. So earlier there were 10 labs and now there have been at least 28 labs that have been added. Which are these prime locations that needed more genome sequencing, and what is the capacity of genome sequencing of samples in these particular labs?
There are two things that we have considered when we have included these additional laboratories for sequencing. One is whether we can have reach out some places where we could not reach in the beginning, you know, when we have this first team. And the second thing is, we also see that, you know, the participation of more might be reducing the turnover time. Because the sequencing is not like an RT-PCR that you can do it in 4 hours or 6 hours time, right? So it's actually several steps involved. And the turnover time by the sample, that the time the sample arrives in your center for sequencing, you have to get the RNA processed, you have to check the quality, you have to find out in the cDNA library, and then you get the sequence. And after the sequence, you have to keep on analyzing. It takes time. It is 10 to 12 days at this time. Now, if you have, and also at the same time, some of the centers have a high capacity machines, which actually can run 384 samples. Now, if you suddenly run hundreds, it's not cost effective. So, you know, we need to have accumulated enough samples to run that big machine. So to somehow complement or supplement that effort, we're now trying to have some of those labs who have high capacity, some of the labs which have a decent moderate capacity into this loop, so that they can actually somehow balance between the pace of sequencing at the same time, the number of sequences.
So to which were these locations you thought that there needed to be more sequencing?
I don't think that any particular area is specially off in, at this moment. We are trying to get it, but we're just trying to have some additive effect so that we can increase the pace of sequencing and the numbers can obviously be increased. But, you know, more than the numbers, you know, we have been discussing with different forum and also some of the international experts. It looks like it's more important is the proper representation of the samples. So it's not, you know, definitely I would just say the numbers is important, but it's also important that you have proper representations of this. Like every district is represented, every corner is represented, or every surge is represented. If there is a sudden surge in a particular district, that should not somehow avoid our attention. That should not somehow overlook our attention. So we have to be very careful that we are not missing any observation. We are not missing any search. We are not missing any event. So we wanted to somehow cover all these possibilities and have a proper representation of the students.
All right. People and experts, epidemiologists have said that India set a target to do 5% of genome sequencing, but has only been able to do about 1%. In a lot of statements from the government, they have said that they are trying to augment the capacity. What are the current steps that the government is taking to make sure that more genome sequencing can be done?
So as I have already elaborated, that's two things. Number one, when this 5% was decided, we had something like 50,000 per day. And then you have seen that it has gone beyond certain expectations. Right? So it has soared so high. So it was not possible. Same time, there are some logistics issues that also we faced because of the supplies. You know, sometimes when we started, the platforms are different. Different centers uses different machines, different platform for analysis. To streamline, it takes some time. And the second thing, as I told you, that we also believe that the numbers are important, but also proper sampling and a proper strategy so that you don't miss out any event is more important, so that you can.
All right. So when international epidemiologists say that lack of COVID genomic sequencing in India has led to the spread of the Delta variant, do you agree or disagree with this statement?
I won't comment on this because, you know, whoever has made some comment, they might have some belief. But I told whatever need to be told. That essentially we are trying to have a proper sampling so that we don't miss out anything. And we try to sequence, and it's the quality of sequence is also important. Interpretation is also important. And those things we are concentrating on.
So do we have evidence that vaccines and monoclonal antibodies are evading the current Delta and Delta plus variants even in India? Because we've seen there are some studies that have been done in Japan, and they say that monoclonals are not really effectively working due to the Delta and the Delta plus variant.
Now, the thing is, when you talk about the monoclonals, they are actually single epitope. So it can happen that because of a particular mutation, that particular epitope may not be so much responsive. But you know, people also use as multiple monoclonals as a cocktail so that you can somehow counter that event. Whatever monoclonal antibody that are not working can be overcome by using a cocktail of monoclonal antibody. And in India, I am not aware. Maybe there are some studies, definitely in some of the centers they are working on it. But that, you know, people have shown convincingly that it actually evades. But there are reports, as you said it correctly, there are some reports that there are studies internationally that are some of the monoclonal antibody did not protect it. That's possible. I mean, that is the expected line.
So the vaccines that we have in India, at least if we talk about the most administered one, Covishield and Covaxin, what is the government currently working on, whether to check these vaccines are working against the Delta and the Delta Plus variants?
No, see, the thing is the vaccines are actually, when you have to remember, there are multiple epitopes, not a single epitope. So it's very unlikely that the virus will mutate to such an extent that all the epitopes can be. So it's not. So, you know, but the studies is definitely are going on in different places to double check that whether the efficiencies are compromised.
So at the moment, So at the moment, there's also this sense that it's like the Delta variant ended up contributing to the second wave in the country. And there's enough emerging evidence and more evidence that has shown that. Could the Delta Plus look at a contributing factor of the third wave in India? We still don't know exactly when the third wave will arrive. There are experts that have mentioned they'll probably be coming in September or October. But what is the sense from INSACOG, from the genomic sequences that you have been looking at, from the samples that you've been looking at, could this Delta Plus contribute to a third wave and be more transmissible than its parent variant?
So it's difficult to predict, certainly. But, you know, all these models are other things suggests that a particular mutation, when it happens, what would be its likely impact in terms of its entry or its pathogenesis. Now, if you really look at this particular variant that we are talking about, there is a mutation from, if I'm not lysine to arginine. So, and because of that mutations, it's likely to disrupt its complex. Now, if it destabilizes the complex of the spike protein with the receptor, then it is actually should somehow not encourage the entry as much as the other variants are doing. But again, as I told you, these are all predictive, but needs to be experimentally validated, and that's all the laboratories are working. So sequencing is one aspect, but a lot of laboratories are working on the biology of this impact, and that needs to be done more aggressively so that we can actually certainly tell your answers.
Right. So one more question for the genome sequencing itself. Private labs have been kept out of doing the genome sequencing of samples. Experts suggest that maybe it could add to the capacity of the labs that already exist. What is the view of the government on inclusion of private labs or the reasons for not including them to do the genome sequencing?
No. We are actually exploring and talking to private labs to be included into the INSACOG and then try to see how they can meaningfully contribute.
Is there a process that they need to follow which would be slightly different from what the government follows? Would there be some kind of non-disclosure clauses? Because these genome sequencing data, these are sensitive information that is in the hands of our scientists. Would you agree?
See, we follow one's SOPs, standard operating practice. So now, if you include any laboratories or private laboratories, government laboratories or private laboratories, they also have to have follow certain SOPs. So those things we are actually working out and ironing out. So so that you know there is no confusion in future.
So would these private labs be accredited by a competent authority? Would they be an NABL accredited lab or a WHO accredited lab? Could you please throw some light on that?
We haven't actually, the discussion is still going on. I think we'll be clear once it is still talking.
Okay. So finally, sir, how afraid do you think public should be from the Delta and the Delta Plus? Because we've heard experts say a lot about finding new mutants and variant strains, but ultimately how important is COVID appropriate behavior to fight and to stay safe from these mutants?
You actually said it. No matter how much the mutation happens, if you are wearing mask, you can protect it. I think the mask is must, because even after vaccine, we are not 100% guaranteed, but the mask can actually prevent any mutations or any other pathogens to enter the host. So I think we should adhere to COVID-appropriate behavior. We have learned this lesson from the first wave to second wave. Mm-hmm. I think we can actually prevent the third wave to happen if all of us actually follow the norms and follow the discipline and, you know, COVID-appropriate behavior. That's the message.
Okay. So then what do you have to say about the unlocking that's currently going on? Because with the unlock, a lot of people have once again developed COVID fatigue. They are not wearing their masks. They are crowding in a lot of areas. Do you think that with new mutations coming forward, India should look at a graded or a simulated concentrated lockdown strategy rather than going for a full lockdown?
Those are policy decisions, and I'm a scientist. So I will just talk in terms of science. So if you say science, then I think, you know, as I told you, you can prevent it by vaccinations. You can prevent it by COVID appropriate. Now, how to implement that? It's another strategy. I think that government will decide.
All right, sir. Thank you so much for joining me on India Today and for the insightful information that you were able to provide on genome sequencing in the country. India is doing all it can to genome sequence samples and to look for mutations and new strains that could potentially be dangerous. But at this point, the government has said, although the Delta Plus variant is a variant of concern, but COVID-appropriate behavior can certainly help quell its spread in the country. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us.
Thank you.